Hi guys, it's Ben here. It's Southampton preview time, the games this weekend. I'm joined by Oliver Bond, the founder and owner of Anfield HQ. Before we get to the Southampton stuff, I think it's important that we clear up something. Obviously, it's been a rough 24 hours. I think lots of you probably know what I'm talking about, especially with Oliver here sat next to me. Liverpool Twitter last night kicked off big time after an article was brought to everyone's attention that had been plagiarised. So I've got Ollie here to kind of talk about that. Don't want to hide from it, so fair play to Ollie for coming on and fronting it, basically. It's not an easy situation for him. Nice one for coming on. So if you're not aware of what happened, there'd been an article written by David Preece in a newspaper, that was obviously published online, and then it basically been regurgitated and submitted to Anfield HQ for to be published on there as well. It got published, so the editor didn't realise that it had been already written elsewhere, which is fair enough. You can't expect someone to go and be aware of that stuff. And then someone noticed this, tweeted about it, and it was obviously named and shamed, and everyone kind of knows who the parties are involved. I'm not going to mention any names because I don't want to offend anybody or upset anybody. I just want to kind of get to the bottom of how this has happened, your take on it, and how we can make sure this doesn't happen again. So it's happened, it's been dealt with. Your thoughts?
Yeah, well, as you said, it's been a pretty difficult last 24 hours. At the end of the day, we publish 50 plus pieces each week, all natural and organic, and all written independently by writers at Anfield HQ. This is just one of those circumstances where, unfortunately, one of our writers decided to just copy someone else's work and submit it to Anfield HQ. Look, at the end of the day, we're not the Times, we're not the Mail, we're not a news outlet, we don't have a newsroom, we don't have the plagiarism resources, and when a piece comes into the site, one of our editors just put it up, not thinking anything different. And unfortunately, it got flagged and it was taken out completely out of context. We did receive an email from the editor of the outlet that obviously the original piece belonged to, asking us to take the piece down, but we didn't get that until sort of after people had finished work, sort of like half six. And look, it just wasn't seen until later in the evening when our Twitter blew up and we got flagged for it.
So, obviously you're not a big national outlet like the papers you mentioned, but no. Obviously a huge social following and a website that obviously gains a lot of clicks and stuff, and it has got a big audience. Obviously there is a responsibility there to be honest and to have your due diligence done and everything. I'm sure you understand that, so obviously you need to make sure this doesn't happen again. Is that something you obviously is going to be a high priority from now on? I know there's only a certain amount of control you can have, but
I've got to take responsibility for it, because at the end of the day, the editor as well, we're the ones that approve the content that goes out on the site, so from our point of view it looks horrific, but we don't have the resource or the personnel to be checking every single piece that comes into Anfield HQ to make sure it's not somewhere else on the site. We trust our writers. We believe they want to write for Anfield HQ in good faith and submit pieces to the site willingly and independently. And the writer in question is also someone who I've known for a while, so it becomes as a big surprise. But in terms of going forward, there are things that have been brought to my attention I wasn't aware of before, like free plagiarism checkers you can install in WordPress, and fact-checking software and things like that, which is something we'll have to utilise going forward. But I can only apologise to David Preece and the outlet which the content originally belonged to, and just assure them that it won't happen again.
Yeah, I guess it is kind of always a risk when your writers you can submit anything, and there's a pool of writers that just want to get their name out there, gain more followers or whatever it is that they're trying to achieve, become a journalist if they're studying it or something. Because I used to edit a website myself, and I remember instances where people would submit pieces and I could see, I've just read that article 20 minutes ago, or they'd even link to the source in the article, and I'd click on that source, I'd go on that link and read the article, and it'd be exactly the same piece. And it's a difficult conversation to have with people. Sometimes they're just a bit naive to it, or they don't understand the laws around it, and obviously you don't want to see people get attacked and kind of called out and bullied for it, so it is a shame to see that. But yeah, I guess it's just one of those things, and it kind of brings up to like, obviously as soon as Anfield HQ gets criticised, people start talking about other things that maybe they don't like about your website. I know there's quite a lot of people that just don't like Anfield HQ, people that maybe work for or write for other websites, or just for some time, haven't just liked how you go about your business or what sort of content you put out. Or obviously the big thing is copying quotes and putting it in on your timeline with the source there. People get upset about that. Your sort of response to that?
Yeah, like we've been, you know, we were flagged late last year for pretty much that, taking, you know, a piece on the club site, an interview, pretty much lifting 10, 12 tweets from it and then putting like a little link at the end. And, you know, from our perspective, we didn't really think we were doing anything. We saw it as, you know, driving traffic to the site, but, you know, in hindsight, it was pretty naive of us to think that. You know, who's really going to click on the link once they've seen half the piece on the socials anyway? So we spoke to a few journalists, we sort of got a bit of their feedback, we apologised, and they sort of gave us a better direction to work in, which we've been doing for 3 months without any problems, really. We haven't had any bad feedback, we haven't had any criticism from journalists or members of the, you know, fans or supporters. I just think it's very unfortunate that this has happened, you know, so, you know, 3 months is not a long time really at all, and this has happened so shortly after we got, you know, flagged publicly last time as well. But I don't think yesterday was just a really unfortunate event. You know, we'll just have to make sure in future, you know, that sort of thing doesn't happen ever. We'll install WordPress plugins for plagiarism, and keep doing what we're doing, because there are also a lot of people that really do enjoy what we actually do. You know, as I said, I can only apologise for to David Priest and to people that, you know, are offended by it. Just make sure it won't happen again.
Yeah, and I think the important thing, I mean, obviously the way social is changing, the way journalism is conceived and stuff, and how it's consumed, it would be a shame if there was to be a divide and a rivalry of sorts between sort of traditional journalists, who it's their full-time job and they work for an outlet, and the likes of yourselves and other fan sites. Obviously, AnthemHQ does monetize, but on a very small scale. You know, it's not, you're not living off it or anything. It's just something that you kind of do, and most of the money that you make off it is put back into maybe paying people to write or edit anyway. So I guess it's important to kind of tell people that you're not rinsing everyone and making loads of money off other people's work.
Yeah, the piece that was up yesterday, I think someone commented saying, you know, AnthemHQ probably taking £200 from that just off the clicks it got, and you know, AnthemHQ doesn't pocket, you know, thousands of pounds every month from articles and clicks. The website itself is quite expensive to run. You think of the, you know, we've got a member of staff full time with us, who edits it on a daily basis. We've got the hosting server of the site is expensive. Sort of your fees to cover little bits and bobs. So it, you know, it's not cheap to run. I don't personally pocket much from AnthemHQ at all. A lot of it goes back into the site, you know, making sure that, you know, the WordPress caches are up to date and everything like that. So, you know, to think we pocket £10,000 a month or whatever is just ludicrous. You know, AnthemHQ does monetize just like any other site out there, and we've just got to find a way of going about it the right way and the correct way.
Yeah, and I think obviously the most important people that you avoid upsetting is those that work hard for the stories.
Yeah.
And I know it's not your intention to take away from them or take away from any potential incomings they might have financially or divert attention from their work towards your site. You know, you do put their names in brackets and you do link to the article, and I'm sure you don't want your relationship with any of the journalists that maybe have called you out or mentioned you on Twitter or anything to have a bad feeling about you.
No, not at all. I mean, I like to think AnthemHQ's had good relationships with a lot of Liverpool-based journalists and national-based journalists for, you know, a few years now. You know, there have been problems over the 3 years, which has meant that, you know, there's been friction caused in the relationships there, and, you know, but at the end of the day, I don't want people to think that AnthemHQ is just in it for themselves, and we're just trying to, you know, rinse people of money, take money away from journalists, just pocket everything. As a lot of the money goes back into the site, I think the other thing to mention is that a lot of people do this, but I think, you know, someone's going to have to make those mistakes, and, you know, unfortunately, we're the ones that have made it, but, you know, you learn from your mistakes, and AnthemHQ just made them, and when you make mistakes to a mass audience, it's going to get picked up on. So I just think going forward, it's sort of important to stress that we're not just trying to fleece people and rinse people of money. You know, it does monetize like any other site does, but we're just trying to provide, you know, the best quality content we can and just, you know, inform Liverpool fans of everything Liverpool.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I mean, I'm a Liverpool fan as well, and there are lots of outlets that I follow and subscribe to, I pay money to for podcasts and watch YouTube videos and read fan sites, and there's loads. We're lucky as a fan base to have so many great outlets out there for us to follow, read, and listen to, and watch. So, you know, obviously, I don't want Ollie and HQ to suffer in any way. And as I say, fair play to him for coming on and clearing that up. So let's touch on Southampton. That's coming up this weekend. slight change of subject. Disappointing point in the end against Spurs, or you can look at it either way. I suppose the way the second half went, we maybe would have been happy with a point. But Southampton away, obviously a lot of our players are from there. How do you see the Reds coping?
I think a lot of the ex-Southampton players who play for the club now have been sent there before, so they know what to expect. Bergeron, like, I don't think we'll have any problems. I think he's got a steely nerve, and I think it's the way his character is, he won't be affected by it too much. I think the atmosphere will be good there. Southampton have been struggling so far this season, so you know they want a big 3 points. But I think we've just got to go there and treat it like Huddersfield, where we control the game, and you know, hopefully get 3 points.
Yeah, so I normally do a pitted lineup, as my regular viewers will know. So let's kind of try and figure that out. So obviously, Karras will stay in goal. Mm-hmm. Right back, Trent played on Sunday. Just seeing him staying there.
I thought Trent had a really, really good game on Sunday. I think Gomez has suffered a little bit in terms of lapses of concentration the last few weeks. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Trent now. I'm pretty sure he's capable of starting 2 games in a row.
Yeah, obviously Van Dijk would be the first name on the team sheet at the back. Lovren played pretty well, apart from that kind of lapse which led to the first goal. The first penalty against Spurs. But I think I'd prefer to see Lovren in there with Van Dijk. I just think they complement each other a bit better. Lovren seems to say that Matip and Van Dijk are both quite calm, whereas Lovren's got a bit more, not panic about him, but a bit more alertness and maybe more of a scat gun approach than Matip. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I think Matip has another very good season, in all honesty. I think he's obviously struggled with injuries, but I think Lovren can feed off Van Dijk a bit better than Matip probably can. I think you're right, he's a bit more alert to the danger. He doesn't always deal with it in the right way, but I think we'll see him start with him.
Yeah, and I think we're all in agreement that Robertson will play left back. The midfield's interesting. It's kind of the hardest trio to kind of pick, especially now Coutinho's left. Henderson back in the fold, I expect him to start again. He got hooked on 60, probably down to fitness, but I think he's okay and will probably play here, the captain.
I think we'll need the energy of Henderson. We saw it against Huddersfield and it was much needed, so I think we'll see.
So Chan played against Spurs as well. It was Wijnaldum and Oxlade-Chamberlain that missed out. I'm kind of maybe leaning towards Oxlade-Chamberlain for this one. Hasn't played for a while. He couldn't get into it off the bench against Spurs, but I feel like he might bring him back in because when he was starting in midfield earlier on this calendar year, he was doing some damage. So maybe looking at a Henderson-Chan Ox perhaps.
The only other thing I think is that Wijnaldum obviously only came on for 20-odd minutes and you know he's utilised well in away games.
And we've got midweek in mind as well, Porto on Wednesday, so I think Gini might start there. I think Milner might start there. It's a hard one to pick. It's probably 1 o'clock's biggest sort of European task away from home so far, so it'd be really interesting to see how he lands up there and whether he'll have that in mind when he picks his Southampton side. And then a front three, surely will pick itself.
Yeah. Salah, Firmino, Mane.
Yeah. Score prediction?
We'll all 3-1 out.
I think we'll go there and win. I think we're due a win after that kind of lapse against Spurs. I know we dropped quite a few points in the last few weeks, obviously out of the FA Cup, beat Huddersfield away. I think Southampton are going to be a similar test, a bit more quality from wide, and Lamina's doing quite well in the midfield, so it'll be a battle in there, but the quality should shine through. Just whether the former Southampton players can handle the pressure. Obviously Van Dijk came back to his old club, he's not going to be welcomed nicely, nor will Dejan Lovren. Again, I wonder if that will come into Klopp's thinking when he picks his team. But I'm going to go for a 2-1 win for the Reds. Cement ourselves in that top four, and then we go from there. So thanks again for Ollie for coming on and talking. Hopefully some people can have a bit more sympathy for you. Or maybe not after sympathy, but obviously kind of a better understanding of what's going on there. And we can all move on and stop kind of arguing on Twitter about it all, because what's the point? Well done for apologising. Let's hope it doesn't happen again. So subscribe to my channel if you're new here, they might say, and obviously Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat and Facebook, the same handle on all of those, and I'll see you next time.